Second part. In search of God's priorities. Chapter 5. A heart that serves. I will make him an help meet for him. Genesis 2 verse 18. It was a bright fall day at the University of Oklahoma. As I hurried to my first class after lunch, he caught my eye again. He smiled as he walked towards where I was. Every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, our paths seemed to cross as he, too, hurried to get to his class. His name, Jim George, was unknown to me at the time, but he seemed extremely nice. He was good-looking, and I loved his smile. Well, it was obvious that he had noticed me too, because a short time later a mutual friend set up a blind date for both of us. This occurred in November 1964. On Valentine's Day we got engaged, and our wedding was the first weekend after finishing school, June 1, 1965. That was 35 years ago, and I wish I could say, that was a wonderful, blissful, happy 35 years, but I can't. You see, we started our marriage without God, and that equals hard times. From the beginning we stumbled, we argued, and we let each other down. Because we have not found fulfillment in our marriage, we pour our lives into different causes, friendships, hobbies, and intellectual pursuits. Having two children also did not fill the void that each of us felt. Our married life was monotonous for 8 frustrating years, until by an act of God's grace, we became a Christian family, a family whose head or center is Jesus Christ, a family with the Bible as our guide. Giving our lives to Jesus Christ made a tremendous difference within our hearts, but how could Christ change our marriage? Each of us had been given a new life in Christ, but what were we to do with the stress in our marriage, and therefore in our home? I had a lot to learn about how to be a woman, a wife, and a mother that pleases God. And fortunately, shortly after making Jesus my Lord and Savior, I had in my hands a calendar that helped me read through the Bible. On January 1, 1974, I began to follow that program, and while I was reading, I did something that I recommend you do as well. I marked each passage that spoke to me as a woman with a pink marker. Well, God started working on my transformation that very day. On January 1st, my first day of reading, I stumbled upon my first assignment as a Christian wife, would serve Jim. I marked these words in pink. It is not good for man to be alone. I will give him an help meet for him. Genesis 2 verse 18. Call to serve. A woman after God's own heart is a woman who carefully cultivates a spirit of servanthood, whether she is married or not. Following in the footsteps of Jesus, dear friend, who did not come to be served but to serve, Matthew 20 verse 28, requires that throughout life attention be paid to the attitude of the heart regarding service. And that attitude and service begins at home, with her family, especially if she is married, with her husband. God has designed a woman to be her husband's helpmate. So the first step on my 1,000-mile path to becoming a godly wife was to begin to understand that I had a mission from God to help my husband. And what does this help from Genesis 2 verse 18 consist of? I borrowed some of Jim's Bible study books and learned that a helpmeet is one who shares man's responsibilities, responds to his nature with understanding and love, and wholeheartedly cooperates with him to accomplish God's plan. Anne Ortland talks about becoming a team with her husband, noting that being a team removes any sense of competition between spouses. Writing about this partnership of marriage, she describes a wife as someone who strongly supports and supports her husband. She says, I have no desire to run alongside Rahul, thus leaving the competition track suddenly. I want to be behind him, cheering him on. I can honestly say that I became a better wife and a better Christian when I became a better helpmeet. Realizing that I was on a mission from God to help my husband opened my eyes. According to God's plan, I was not to compete with Jim. Instead of doing it, I was to support and endorse it. He's the one who's supposed to win, and I'm supposed to contribute to making his victory possible. Reading about Mamie Eisenhower, the wife of former President Dwight David Eisenhower, gave me more insight into what it means to be a helpmeet. Julie Nixon Eisenhower explained, Mamie had played her role as an emotional support for her husband. She had no interest in promoting herself. Above all else, she was the woman behind the man, the woman who proudly declared, Ike is my career. As God impressed on my heart the importance of a spirit of service, especially in my role as a helpmeet for my husband, I wrote a prayer of commitment. As I did so, I took a few steps back, making sure that in my heart, Jim was clearly in front and I was definitely behind him to help him. That day, and in that prayer to God, I began a life of service to Jim that has continued for more than 2 decades. I certainly have many personal things to do, but my main purpose and role for each day is to help Jim share his responsibilities, respond to his nature, and cooperate wholeheartedly with him in God's plan for our life together. Yes, but how? How can we develop a heart committed to serving, a heart with the intention of emulating Christ in serving another person? What can a woman do so that God can create in her a heart committed to helping her husband? Consider these suggestions. Be committed to helping your husband. Will it become a help or not? Will she follow God's plan to help her husband or not? Will she make her husband her career or not? The decision is yours. And when you make up your mind, you may want to write your own prayer of commitment to God. Let your words reflect the decision to help your husband, to be a team with him, and to make helping him your career. A woman after God's own heart fully fulfills her commitment to help her husband, first clearing any outstanding accounts. She wrote, I realized that I needed to ask the Lord and my husband to forgive me. I also needed to start applying the Word of God in our marriage. With that in mind, he began to nurture a heart committed to service. Focus on your husband. God wants us wives to focus our energies and efforts on our husbands, on their tasks, their goals, their responsibilities. I know this can be an area of struggle, as our sinful nature screams, me first. However, God wants us to say to our husbands, you first. So often ask yourself this question regarding your marriage, who is number one? One practical way that I try to focus on Jim and his responsibilities is by asking him 2 questions each day. What can I do for you? And what can I do to help you use your time better today? You may worry, as I did in the beginning, about the requests your husband may make that consume a lot of your time. But I have to tell you, the first time I asked Jim these questions, all he wanted was for me to sew a button on his favorite sports coat. That was it. And for me it was not at all cumbersome to pull out a needle and thread and make Jim my number one human priority, just by sewing on a little button. Sometimes, however, their demands are greater. Last week, for example, was a week of greater demands, as Jim was preparing to travel to Germany for 5 months with his armed reserves unit. The days were filled with physical chores, With things like rushing to the safe for wills, birth certificates, and marriage licenses, to visit the dentist, extract blood, getting mortgage records, passports, and preparing email, along with fixing up the house and organizing his work before he left the country, and all this as the due date for the delivery of my book was approaching. However, even though I sometimes don't like the answers Jim gives to my two questions, his answers can completely change the schedule of my day. I want him to be my number one human priority and for him to know that it is. After all, that is my task from God, to make his life easier, helping him. Even if you don't have a husband, you can still nurture a heart of Christian service by focusing on serving and helping others. Whether you are married or not, serving those around you pleases God and allows the world to see Christ. Evaluate your actions. This will help or hinder my husband. Let me give you a simple example. Your husband's boss asks you to go away on a business trip, and you are annoyed and punished because you have to go. Does that attitude help or hinder your husband? That simple question can be a good lens. Through evil, we see how we act in our marriage. One of my heroines is Ruth Graham, wife of evangelist Billy Graham. When my husband was a full-time seminary student and full-time church worker traveling extensively with our missions pastor, I took advantage of that time to read every book I could find on Mrs. Graham. Because her famous husband was away from home for about 10 months of the year, I learned a lot from her about being alone. Pay attention to this wise statement. We have to learn to give less importance to things that are moving away and more importance to things that are coming closer. These words of encouragement from a colleague have made me a better help to Jim as he prepares for each trip, including his 5 months in Germany, and has lessened my urge to tease or punish him. Let me give you another example. Your husband has told you the status of the budget, but you want something right away and are pushing for it. From experience, I know this situation. We had lived in our house, the one with the peeling paint and the uneven ceiling, for over a decade, and finally it was time to do some remodeling. I was ecstatic. For me, what our charming little house had been missing for all these years was a wood-burning fireplace, and this was our chance to install one. But Jim sat down and made it clear to me that there wasn't enough money in our budget to add one. However, I wanted that fireplace. So he'd say things like, "Wouldn't this be a wonderful night to watch the fire in the fireplace?" Or, "Imagine if we had a wood-burning fireplace, we could put some logs in and dine in front of a warm fire." But then I asked myself, "Liz, are you helping or hindering?" I knew the answer immediately, and so did you. One day God helped me understand that I was bullying Jim, and I promised before the Lord not to mention the fireplace to him again. I wrote that commitment in a prayer to God, and I'm thankful for God's grace. I never mentioned the fireplace again. Another example. Your husband thinks they should move so he can better provide for the family, and you either don't want to or firmly say no to that place. Being a pastor, my husband counseled a couple in this situation. The husband was a truck driver and wanted to change his job due to the wear and tear that he himself brought to their marriage. It was for this reason that they initially came for counseling. Finally, he was presented with a very good job opportunity half a state away, where they could buy a house and start their family. Mariella, however, did not want to move. She loved her job and was next to get a big promotion. But when she realized that God's plan was that she should help her husband, who was trying to provide better financially through another job, and wanted spiritually to improve the situation of their marriage, she understood that she should help and not hinder his leadership. So they moved, and what an abundant blessing God had waiting for this precious couple in their new town. Yet another example. Your husband wants to have a daily time to read the Bible together as a family, but you don't, or you don't want to study what he has chosen, or you never get up early enough to have breakfast ready in time for you to have breakfast. Family devotional. In most families, the wife is usually responsible for the itinerary at home in the morning. And because she controls the schedule, she has the ability to make time for family worship happen or not happen. If your heart is committed to service, you have the power to help your husband accomplish this goal and any other. Is your heart committed to serving, especially serving your husband? Heart response. Help. It is a simple and noble task. And great reward is reaped. Living out God's mission certainly benefits our husbands and anyone else we serve, but we also benefit as we learn to serve as Christ Himself served. Being a servant is a sign of Christian maturity. It is the true mark of Christ. Philippians 2 verse 7, who served to the point of death. Matthew 20 verse 28. So how do you qualify as a helper? In your marriage, do you see yourself as part of a team, free from all competitive actions, thoughts, or desires? Is your husband your main career? Is helping your husband the main concern of your heart and the main focus of your energy? Have you committed your life and your heart to following God's plan for you? The plan to help and not hinder your husband. As you and I promote the well-being of our husbands, and the well-being of others God has placed in our lives, our service will glorify God. Chapter 6. A Heart That Submits. Having started down the path that would become more and more of a help to my husband, I continued to read my Bible. As I did, I found out more about my role as a wife, and I saw other tidbits that I needed if I was to become the kind of wife God intended me to be. In fact, the number of times my pink marker marked the pages showed me that I had a lot of work ahead of me. The other important aspect that I noticed was that I had a mission from God to submit to my husband. Being a new Christian, the concept of submission struck me as somewhat foreign, and I had to do some research. When I did, I discovered that in the Bible, submission, wifetasso, in Greek, is basically a military term meaning to place yourself under the command of another person. This attitude of the heart is lived through submission and obedience, letting things be judged by another person, yielding or referring to another person's opinion or authority. As I already said, the concept was foreign to me and I had doubts in my heart. But I kept studying and praying to be a woman and wife after God's own heart, and certain revelations from the Bible helped me better understand the attitude of the heart regarding the submission that God desires in His women. The facts about submission. First of all, the fact is that the Christian lifestyle for both men and women involves submission. You and I are called to submit to each other, Ephesians 5 verse 21. God's desire for us, whether we are married or not, whether we are young or old, is that we honor, serve, and submit to one another. We reflect the character of Christ to the extent that we move away from selfishness and act with honor towards other people, referring to them. The heart of God's people, of their women and of their church, must be a heart willing to submit, dedicated to honoring and yielding to others. As far as marriage is concerned, God established for the sake of order that the husband led and the wife follow. for the marriage to walk well, God has said. Now, I want you to understand that Christ is the head of every man, while the man is the head of the woman and God is the head of Christ. First letter of Corinthians 11 verse 3. But don't be alarmed. The leadership of the man does not mean that we wives cannot offer wise advice, Proverbs 31 verse 26, or ask clarifying questions during the decision-making process. However, the husband's leadership does imply that he is responsible for the final decision. Author Elizabeth Elliot describes her father's leadership during her childhood. Head of the family did not mean that our father barked orders, did his bidding without consideration, and demanded submission from his wife. It only meant that he was ultimately the one responsible. After all, the husband has to give an account to God for his decisions as a leader, and we have to give an account to God for how we submitted to that leadership. Our husbands answer to God for his leadership, and we answer to how we follow his leadership. Now I ask you, which of these responsibilities would you enjoy most? God's instructions for the man to be the leader and the woman to follow result in both beauty and order. I remember as a child seeing a stuffed goat head in a museum. The only weird thing was that it had two heads. It was abnormal, grotesque, a strange reaction, a curiosity, and so is a marriage with two heads. But God, the perfect artist, designed marriage to be beautiful, natural, and functional by giving it one head, the husband. Thank you, Lord. Marriage is your work of art. The decision to submit. Another passage marked in pink taught me that I had a responsibility to submit or not. He said, "Wives, submit, or submit, to your own husbands as to the Lord," Ephesians 5 verse 22. Submission is a wife's decision. She decides whether to submit to her husband or not. No one can do it for her, and no one can make her do it. Your husband cannot force you to submit. Your church cannot force you to submit. Your pastor cannot force you to submit, nor can a counselor. She herself must decide to submit to her husband. I was surprised and grew as a Christian woman when I read about four women like you and me, who met weekly to study the Bible. One week they stumbled upon the first letter of Corinthians 11 verse 3. A verse that deals with the leadership of the husband in the marriage. This is the verse that we just saw that tells us. Now, I want you to understand that Christ is the head of every man, while man is the head of woman and God is the head of Christ. Coming face to face with God's plan caused them to make some decisions. That night's leader read the verse aloud, paused, and read again. Each of those women, it was known to all, were the head in their marriage. Someone said weakly, "Does St. Paul say anything else about leadership and submission?" An index was consulted, and the other Pauline statements were read, Colossians 3 verse 18, Ephesians 5 verse 22, and First Letter to Timothy 2 verse 11. There was a bit of discussion. Finally, the leader said, "Well, girls, what shall we do?" Someone else said, "We have to." Then came the miracle. In less than a year, the four women, with wonder and delight, were telling each other, and almost every other woman they knew, what had happened. The spouses, the four of them, had silently taken their place, and without exception, each of the women felt that her marriage had been in a new dimension of happiness and joy that they had never had before. The dimension of doing the right thing. Seeing this so amazing that no one thought possible, the four wives one day realized an even more astonishing truth. Their husbands had never claimed and never would claim leadership, It could only be a free gift from the wife to her husband. Are you offering the gift of leadership to your husband through the attitude of a submissive heart? Are you experiencing the security that comes from deciding to follow God's plan for your marriage? The who of submission. The who of insubmission is clear in Ephesians 5 verse 22. Wives, submit to your own husbands. EPH 22. Italics by the author, not to other people we admire or respect. And this is an important distinction. A Christian woman, married to a man who was not a believer, came to me for advice. Susanna wanted to quit her job and attend a Bible college for 4 years in order to prepare and dedicate herself to Christian work full-time. After telling me the desires of his heart, I asked him, "Well, Susanna, what does your husband say about this?" She answered me immediately, "He doesn't want me to." "Why, Susanna?" I exclaimed, "God has spoken." You see, God's plan for marriage is for each wife to honor and submit to her husband. When Susanna discussed her dreams with her pastor and her Christian boss, they both told her to go ahead with her plans. She was very willing to follow other people's guidance. But the Bible is clear. We are to submit to our own husbands, not to the leader of a church, not to other people we respect, not even to our own father. Sometimes we are tempted to push God's plan aside, saying, "My husband is not walking with God, so I don't have to submit to him." Or, "My husband is not a Christian, so I don't have to submit to him." The Apostle Peter wrote the following words, to help women who were precisely in that situation, women with incredulous and disobedient husbands. "In the same way, you women, be subject to your husbands, so that also those who do not believe the word may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives." 1 letter of Peter 3 verse 1. In other words, our subjection to our husbands, whether he is a Christian or not, whether he is obeying God or not, preaches a more loving and powerful sermon than our mouths could deliver on any occasion. It is important that we mention here the exception that exists regarding following the husband's advice, which occurs if he asks her to violate something that the Word of God teaches. If he asks you to do something illegal or immoral, go to a pastor you trust and follow the advice you receive there. The how of submission. In addition to clarifying the who, Ephesians 5 verse 22 also gives us the how of submission. Wives, submit, or submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, author's italics. As soon as I stopped submitting to Jim and began to think about submitting to the Lord, my submission struggle slowly subsided. In my own mind, I put Jim aside, and that allowed me to face the face of the Lord. Suddenly, the how of submission became so much simpler and easy. My submission had nothing to do with Jim, and everything to do with the Lord. As a familiar scripture puts it, "And whatever you do, including submitting to my husband, do it from the heart, as for the Lord and not for men." Colossians 3 verse 23, italics by the author. What a blessing to be able to apply this scripture to honor, submit and follow Jim. The scope of submission. But what is the extent of our submission to our husbands? In what matters, decisions and situations must we submit? In two words, everything. Just as the church submits to Christ, so wives must submit to their husbands in everything. Ephesians 5 verse 24, italics by the author. The writing is clear. In everything. So whenever I'm tempted to say, "Yes, but," or "What if," I try to remember these two little words, in everything. Those two words cover big and small matters alike. After the massive collapse caused by the 1994 California earthquake, Jim and I went together to pick out light fixtures to replace those that had broken. We were happy to have found a Tiffany glass table lamp. However, when we brought our lamp home, my heart dropped when I opened the box and saw its faded colors. Greens and pinks would never match the bright green in our library, but Jim thought it looked good and said there was no reason to return it. It wasn't easy, but I didn't say anything, seeing this as another chance to submit to my husband, as to the Lord, in everything, and without saying a word. I admit that the lamp is a tiny thing, but these little things are a good place to start to indulge in everything. We'll get to bigger things later, but right now ask God to give you the grace to submit when the next little thing comes your way. The strength to submit. Do you know the main reason why we don't submit to our husbands? God says it is out of fear. We are afraid of what might happen if our husbands do things their way instead of ours. Of course, beyond God's call for submission lies a deeper and more fundamental call to live a life of faith in Him. This is how the holy women of the Bible who hoped in God adorned themselves in ancient times, each one submissive to her husband, and we can follow in their footsteps if we do good and live without any fear. First letter of Peter 3 verses 4 to 6. Faith is the opposite of fear. Mark 4 verse 40, but how does faith square with submission? It is by faith that you and I believe that God works directly in our lives through our husband. It is by faith in our sovereign God that we submit to our husbands, trusting that God knows their decisions and the end result of those decisions, and trusting that God redeems, if not He who guides those decisions. So it is by faith in God that our fear is dispelled and we can receive the strength to submit. As you learn more about submitting to your husband, why not ask God like the disciples did to increase your faith, Luke 17 verse 5. Faith in God gives us the strength to obey and submit to our husbands. The reason for submission. Perhaps the scripture that touched my heart the deepest when God's call to submission was taking root was this: teach young women to be subject to their husbands, so that the word of God may not be blasphemed, be discredited, dishonored, Titus 2 verses 4 and 5, italics by the author. As I meditated on these verses, the idea of submitting to my husband suddenly jumped into the heavenly realm, overriding all earthly, poor, selfish, carnal excuses for not wanting to submit to Jim. Once again, it became clear to me that my submission had nothing to do with Jim and everything to do with God. He has instituted submission, He has commanded submission, and He is honored when I do. My obedience to my husband testifies to all who are watching that God's word and His ways are right. This call to submission is actually a great call. Yes, but how? How does a wife submit to her husband? Here are some steps I have taken. Give your heart to honoring your husband. A change requires a decision, and that is ultimately the case with submission. You and I have to make the decision to submit to our husband, make the decision to practice submission, and dedicate our hearts to honor God and our husband in this way. Remember to respect it. Submission flows from the fundamental attitude of respect of the heart. God says, "And let the wife respect her husband." Ephesians 5 verse 33, italics by the author. God does not tell us to feel respect, but to show respect, to act with respect. A good way to measure our respect for our husbands is by answering the question, am I treating my husband as I would treat Christ Himself? You show your respect to your husband in small everyday moments. For example, do you ask your husband to do something to you, or rather order him to? Do you stop, watch and listen to him when he is talking to you? When he talks about him, do you do it with respect? Respond to your husband's words and actions in a positive way. Oh, submission was a bit difficult for me. I was a student in the 1960s, a decade of protest against all authority, and I was part of the women's liberation movement in the 1970s. So when I was converted, I had a lot to learn about God and the loving women I found at my church. However, old habits are hard to break. I lunged, hissed, kicked, and fought with Jim about everything, which lane to drive in, whether or not we bought the sweet rolls on the way to church on Sunday mornings, his method of disciplining the children versus mine, how we were doing to manage his ministry. Our struggles were continuous. I knew what the scripture said, I had even memorized the passages we had been considering, but I still couldn't submit. For me, progress started to show with the implementation of a positive feedback. I trained myself to respond positively to anything and everything my husband said or did. And the training was a two-phase process. First phase. Say nothing. Have you ever been in the presence of a woman who did not respect her husband? She scolds him, corrects him, and disagrees with him in public. She corrects him and fights with him over the slightest thing. No, Juan, it wasn't 8 years ago, it was 7 years ago. Either stop him, interrupt him, or worse, finish his sentences for him. Obviously, being able to say nothing is a huge improvement over that kind of behavior. Keeping silent is also a giant step towards submission. All we have to do to give a positive answer is keep our mouths shut and say nothing. It took me a while, but I finally understood that my mouth doesn't have to be always moving. I don't always have to express my opinions, especially after Jim has made a decision. Why talk about thoughts that I'm going to regret later? Second phase. Respond with positive words. After I got pretty good at saying nothing in the first phase, I graduated to phase two, where I began to respond with positive words. Choose to say, of course, between exclamation points and in a melodious voice. So I started using this positive response and I was saying of course. In the little things. My dear friend Deborah also chose to say, of course, and let me tell you something that happened in your family as a result of this. Deborah's husband loves to go to the Price Club, a crowded and noisy discount store, and on many occasions he would announce after dinner, let's all go to the Price Club. Well, Deborah, with three children, one of them a baby at the time, could have made an excellent case against taking the whole family to the Price Club after dark when the children had to go to the club the next day. School, but she didn't. She also never challenged Dumas' leadership in front of her small family. Instead, he just smiled and said, of course, and put everyone in the car for another trip to Price's. Many years later, as each of Deborah's family members shared at Thanksgiving dinner their favorite things they did as a family, the three grown children said, go to the Price Club as a family. Family unity, fun and good memories arose because of Deborah's sweetheart, and word, submissive. Once you have started to respond positively to small things, you will soon find that it becomes easy and even natural to respond positively to bigger and bigger things, like buying a car, changing jobs, and moving house. I myself was surprised one morning at 5:30 a.m. when the phone rang. Jim was calling from Singapore, where he was traveling with our mission's pastor. He didn't say, "Hi, how are you? How are the kids? I miss you so much. I love you so much. I can't wait to see you again." Instead, he said without consideration, "How would you like me to move to Singapore and minister?" And out of my mouth he came out. Of course, followed by, "Where is it?" Maybe it was because it was so early, or because he felt Jim's absence, or because he was surprised. Or maybe it was because in the last 10 years I had grown in the area of submission. Whatever the reason, my growth in submission and responding positively paid dividends. God gave me the grace to say, "Of course." Eventually we went to Singapore and served there for a year. It was a wonderful experience for our 10 and 11-year-old daughters as well as Jim and me. The four of us liked it so much that we wanted to spend the rest of our lives there. Ask yourself about every word, action, or attitude you have. Am I giving in or resisting? When tension builds in her heart and you are resisting or doubting her husband's direction, ask yourself, am I giving in or resisting? Your answer will point out the problem. I have said enough. Heart response. Dear friend, don't let this look at God's standards for marriage be a cold exercise. We are mainly talking about a response from the heart. Your husband will be your partner for life. Either way, he is God's good and perfect gift to you. Part of God's plan for your personal performance and most importantly for your spiritual development. Her Christian character becomes evident every time she heartily chooses to yield, bow down, honor, and submit to her husband. Submitting to your husband is one way that as a woman after God's own heart, you honor God. So I encourage you to do as I did. Transfer the idea of submission from the human realm to the heavenly realm. Look fully into the wonderful face of God, and then submit to your husband as to the Lord. What if you don't have a husband? God gives each of us, His daughters, countless opportunities each day to develop a heart that honors other people. Based on honor to God, you can give preference to other people in your life. Romans 12 verse 10. Your dedication to honoring other people honors God and brings a beauty to your life that reflects a heart after God. Dear female reader friend, on behalf of the team of the Christian Polyglot greets you and blesses you, and I am pleased that you enjoy this work that we have humbly prepared for you. We want to thank you for joining us in this project where our goal is to bless your life with books that build your Christian life. Also offer you adaptations in your language so that you can enjoy them and understand them easily. Now we would like to read your opinion and suggestions about future editions of books that you would like to hear in your language that you have not yet been able to hear. If you like this work that we have prepared especially for you, we ask you to help us grow by liking the channel and subscribing, and thus reach new believers who want to feed their Christian life. We are waiting for you next week to continue enjoying new chapters of this book called A Woman According to God's Heart, written by Elizabeth George, author of this book and many more, dedicated to the Christian life of women. Also wife of Jim George, pastor and Christian speaker. Follow us in this new series created and designed especially for Christian women, where we will learn how to be a woman with a heart willing to the will of God. Next week we will continue learning how to have the heart of a woman who loves her husband.